Let's look at an example with conditional probability. Suppose we have three events, R, A, and T, where R is the event that is a Red Sox game, A is the event that there's an accident downtown, and T is the event that there's unusually bad traffic. So PR is 50-50, equally likely to be 1 or 0. PA is also 50-50, so equal 50-50 chance of having a game, independently 50-50 chance of having an accident. Now, whether or not there's traffic depends on whether there's a game and whether there's an accident. So this table shows the probability that T is 1 for each configuration of R and A. So if they're both 0, then the probability of having traffic is bad traffic is 0.3. If either one is 0, or if they're sorry, if either one is 1, or if they're both 1, then the probability goes up to 0.9. So this table shows us this distribution for t equals 1. The distribution for t equals 0 would just have 1 minus this in every entry. And now part A asks us, what's the probability that R is 1? Part B says, what's the probability that R is 1 given that T is 1? And part C says, what's the probability that R is 1 given that T and A are both 1? So let's look at the let's look at part A first. So the probability that R is 1 is given to us over here. It's given to us at 0.5. That was easy. But in B and C, we're asked to find information about R given T, whereas the problem setup gives us information about T in terms of R. So we'll use Bayes' rule to turn the conditioning around. So P of RA given T. And in both cases, we're only interested in the case where T is 1. So we'll fix T at 1 and not worry about the full distribution for now. Bayes' rule tells us that this is the probability of PT given RA. Times P of R and A, which is, since they're independent, just the product of the two. And divided by PT. Sorry, this should be a 1. Because we're only interested in the case where T is 1. So we're interested in this thing for different values of R and A. And since this is going to be a distribution over R and A, anything that we get is going to have to sum up to 1 for every possible value. That is, the four different possibilities for R and A should all sum up, the probabilities should all sum up to 1. And if we look carefully, we'll see that in this case, because R and A are independent, 50-50, these are going to be the same for every combination of R and A. Similarly, the denominator is also going to be the same for every R and A. So what we can do is take a little shortcut and say that this is not equal to, but is equal to some constant C, right, where these terms here and this term here, just we can say that they're constant, they don't depend on R and A, and we can write this as constant times PT. And so we know that this is just going to be this table right here. So it's some constant times this table. So if we write it out, we can see that let's copy this over. Why don't we move this table down? So we can see that this becomes, well, if we write out the table unnormalized, so for every different, so the two R values are 0 and 1, the two A values are also 0 and 1, and the probabilities are 0.3, 0.9, 0.9, 0.9. Except we know that they have to sum to 1. So if we take everything and divide by their sum, then they'll sum to 1. And if we do the math, then this adds up to exactly 3. 0.9, 0.9, 0.9 gives us 2.7. Add an extra 0.3 and we get 3. So if we divide by 3, then we get 0.1, 0.3, 0.3, 0.3. Okay, so this table gives us the distribution of R and A given T. In part B, we're asking for the probability that R is 1, given that T is 1. So in this case, we don't care about A. We only care about R being 1. So we look at the probability of R being 1, conditioned on our event T equals 1, and we sum over all the different A's. We're marginalizing over A. So this is 0.3 plus 0.3. So we'll circle this in red and say that this is 0.6. Now what about the conditional distribution R equals 1 given T equals 1 and A equals 1? Well, if we condition on A equals 1, then we'll do this one in green. If we condition on A equals 1, then we're restricting ourselves to this column here. And if we restrict ourselves to this column, then the probability that R is 1, well, it's 0.3 divided by the marginal probability of the column. That is 0.3 divided by 0.6. So this column becomes our new universe of possibilities. And within this column, what's the probability that R is 1? Well, it occurs half the time, because it's equally likely to be 0 or 1. So here, our probability goes back down to 0.5. So intuitively, why is this? Why does our probability change? So when we had more information the first time, t equals 1, our probability went up from 0.5 to 0.6. But when we added even more, then it went back down. Well, if we go back and look at this scenario, what this is asking is, given that there's traffic, what's the probability that there was a game? Well, it's a little higher, right? Because we know games cause traffic. So if there was traffic, then it's reasonable to assume that there was a game. So the probability goes up. But we know that both games and accidents cause traffic. So if we know that there was traffic, and we know that there was an accident, then it's more likely that the traffic was caused by the accident. So this is called explaining away, where once we observe one explanation, that is, the accident, our belief in a different explanation, the Red Sox game, goes back down.